Chapter 3. The Primary Control.
Do you think me a learned, well-read man? Certainly, replied Zigong. Aren't you? Not at all, said Confucius. I have simply grasped one thread which links up all the rest. Zima Qian.
So far, two main points have been made. One, that the individual always acts as a whole, and two, that manner of use influences functioning and manner of reaction. Taken together, they mean that our functioning and manner of reaction are related to the way we use our entire psychophysical self. We cannot adequately deal with a specific problem, such as a shoulder problem, for example, without considering the use of the whole organism. Nor can we properly analyze an emotional disturbance without reference to the psychophysical whole. Any perspective which fails to recognize general conditions in the whole self may be looking at symptoms only and may leave fundamental causes unrecognized, causes which could create further, perhaps more serious problems in the future. However, this potentially poses a large problem. Does it mean we have to attend to every single joint, every muscle, every thought, every emotion, all at the same time? How can we possibly change the manner of use of the whole psychophysical self when it is so complex, comprised of so many different parts, each performing a different role? It would seem like an insurmountable task, requiring the ability to keep track of thousands of different parts, movements, and thoughts simultaneously. However, the task is much easier than it first appears. For one of the most significant discoveries made by F.M. Alexander was the existence of the primary control, a means to control and coordinate the manner of use of the organism as a whole without having to control each separate part in minute detail. As he described it,
there is a primary control of the use of the self which governs the working of all the mechanisms and so renders the control of the complex human organism comparatively simple.
The fact that all human activity relies on a coordinating pattern of organization is no evolutionary or physiological accident. Any complex system must have coordination. A means must exist for relating and coordinating the actions of parts, and for integrating the various subroutines into a coherent activity. It is otherwise impossible to account for the complex integrity of the human organism. In any activity, very many muscles will need to be actively contracted, whilst many others will need to release and lengthen. When all processes, muscular, nervous, cognitive, and so on, are coordinated together, it enables a coherent and efficient action. When they are not, then there is conflict, inefficiency, strain, and damage. A great deal of this coordination is undoubtedly achieved by highly complex processing in the central nervous system, combined with the complex interaction of forces that muscles exert on each other, on tendons, ligaments, bones, joints, and so on. This level of detail is, and probably always will be, below the level of conscious awareness. However, what Alexander discovered was that this fine coordination depends upon a certain dynamic relationship between the parts at a higher and simpler level, beginning with the head's relationship to the neck. This higher level of organization is within our conscious control and thus provides us with the way to ensure the optimum coordination of the whole and to employ the most constructive manner of use in any activity. This organizing of the relationship of the parts is what he termed the primary control. Unfortunately, the fact that we can exert conscious control over this highest level of our coordination, the fact that it is not a fixed or hardwired aspect of our organization, also means that we can unknowingly interfere with it. In the vast majority of people, this is exactly what happens. And this interference is what makes poor habits of use possible. Habits which bring about the range of problems referred to in the previous chapter. The primary control consists of maintaining a certain use of the head in relationship to the neck. Maintaining a certain use of the head and neck in relationship to the torso, and maintaining a certain use of the head, neck, and torso in relation to the upper and lower limbs. This may seem like a strange way to describe it, but there is an order and hierarchy to the primary control, which this description accurately reflects. When this particular use of the parts is maintained in activity, the proper coordination of the organism as a whole is obtained, ensuring that the more complex details of action can be automatically and accurately coordinated by lower-level processes. It ensures that the optimum conditions are maintained for such processes as digestion, circulation, respiration, perception, and thought. It maintains balance, stability, and the reliability of the sensory input upon which our success in action and our emotional equilibrium depend. Think of it like the board of directors of a large corporation. The board, ideally, organizes the business under one coherent and coordinated strategy, enabling it to function smoothly in the pursuit of its objectives. It ensures that the marketing department is not at odds with production, and that the finance department is not off following its own agenda. It does not concern itself, however, with all of the fine details of running the business. These are taken care of at lower levels. The directors are not concerned, for example, with the amount of paper clips in the stationery cupboard. So it is in the human organism. Our responsibility is to attain coordination at the top level, leaving the finer detail to automatic processes. The primary control is how you can achieve this if you can learn to employ it properly and stop interfering with it. To use another analogy, it's like the cliche of the runaway stagecoach, which you see in old Western movies. In a typical scene, there is a stagecoach pulled by a team of horses who, having been startled by gunfire, are charging out of control towards some hazard, such as a cliff, pulling their terrified passengers behind them. The hero in these scenes is faced with the dangerous task of climbing out of the stagecoach and bringing the charging horses back under control. He achieves this not by directly controlling each horse in the team, but by climbing out onto the lead horse. If he succeeds in turning the lead horse, the rest follow, and he saves the stagecoach from going over the cliff. This may be Hollywood fantasy, but it illustrates the point. Take care of the primary control, and the rest will follow. The role of the primary control in coordinating our manner of use and establishing the optimum conditions for general functioning was described by Alexander in The Universal Constant in Living.
I discovered that a certain use of the head in relation to the neck and of the head and neck in relation to the torso and other parts of the organism, if consciously and continuously employed, ensures, as was shown in my own case, the establishment of a manner of use of the self as a whole, which provides the best conditions for raising the standard of the functioning of the various mechanisms, organs, and systems. I found that in practice, this use of the parts, beginning with the use of the head in relation to the neck, constituted a primary control of the mechanisms as a whole, involving control in process right through the organism, and that when I interfered with the employment of the primary control of my manner of use, this was always associated with a lowering of the standard of my general functioning.
The huge importance of the relationship between the head and neck, and between the head, neck, and other parts, was a completely new concept when Alexander discovered it. It is surprising, however, that it has proved such a difficult idea for people to grasp when similar observations, made in relation to horses and other animals, have been almost taken for granted. The author, Aldous Huxley, writes,
"Thus, the bearing rein was introduced to improve the appearance of carriage horses by drawing back the head in relation to the neck. The result of its use was that the poor beasts so harnessed suffered great discomfort, lost half their pulling power, and were rapidly exhausted."
If we can grasp the harmful effects of interfering with the relationship between the head and neck in carriage horses, why is it so much more difficult to consider it in relation to ourselves? Perhaps it is because the interference Alexander observed in human beings is not the result of reins or any other external forces, but is the result of our own musculature, acting according to our own habits. But this is not the only reason. There are three other reasons why the concept of the primary control has proved to be a difficult concept, and why it has been largely overlooked by mainstream science and medicine. First of all, the primary control is a pattern of organization and coordination, and not an anatomical structure. You will not find it in any textbook of anatomy. Anatomists dissect, name, and describe the parts of the body, often ascribing a discrete function to each part they name. The primary control, however, is a pattern of relationships, which involves all parts in ways which cannot be predicted by the study of any part in isolation. It is only seen in studying the whole behavior of living human beings. A cadaver on the dissecting table does not have a primary control. But before this begins to sound a bit mystical, just think that you can say pretty much the same thing about something as ordinary as a sneeze. It, too, is a pattern of use of the organism and does not refer to a discrete structure that can be labeled in an anatomy chart. It is highly unlikely that a visiting Martian would ever deduce the existence of the sneeze in human beings by dissecting the respiratory system, for the sneeze involves the coordination of many parts, all of which have other, more obvious functions. The big difference, of course, is that the sneeze is a very overt piece of behavior. No scientist had to discover it, whereas the primary control is very subtle. Its discovery required painstaking observation and a major shift to a perspective which views the organism as a whole. Because a great deal of medical science has been based on dissection or a focus on specific parts, relatively little study has been done on the behavior and control of the whole living human being. It is not so surprising that the primary control remained undiscovered for so long, was found first by someone who was not a medical scientist by training, and still proves to be a difficult concept. It is also not so surprising that the medical institutions have been slow to appreciate the significance of this discovery. In an account of the 10 greatest discoveries of medicine, Doctors Friedman and Friedman describe how time and again the greatest of discoveries went unappreciated for years. Alexander Fleming, for example, was trying to grow bacteria in a petri dish when one of his experiments was ruined by a mold growth. He fortuitously noticed that this mold seemed to act against the bacteria, a discovery which eventually led to penicillin, the first of the antibiotics. He published his findings in 1929, but no one in the scientific community, not even Fleming himself, recognized its importance for over a decade. This blind spot was due to a fixed idea dominating medicine at the time, that a systemic bacterial infection could not be treated by an injection. Fleming only thought he had discovered a useful antibacterial ointment or wash.
It was not the first time, nor would it be the last, that recognition of a revolutionary medical discovery was delayed for many years because medical thinking was constrained by an obsolete paradigm of reasoning.
The obsolete paradigm of reasoning that constrains medical thinking in regards to Alexander is much more fundamental. It is the idea of the divided self, the idea that the best way to understand the human being is to divide it into ever smaller parts to be studied by specialists. The second reason why the primary control is sometimes misunderstood is the fact that this certain relationship between the parts is defined in terms of direction, not position. There is no such thing as a right position, or, for that matter, a wrong position, but there is such a thing as a right direction. If this seems confusing, consider a pair of magnets. It is not strange to ask, what is the direction of the force they exert on each other? Is it attractive or repulsive? Towards each other or away? This direction is not related to position, for we can move our magnets closer to each other or further away, changing their relative position. But the direction of force will remain the same, provided we haven't reversed the poles. In the relationship between the head and neck, we are concerned with whether or not we are stiffening or tightening, which tends to pull the head down upon the spine, or doing the opposite, which tends to allow the head to move forwards and upwards. Students can waste a great deal of time and energy trying to find the right position. Trying to hold a position, however, only cultivates rigidity. It limits your range of movement and expression and produces a robotic result. In contrast, when the Alexander technique is used properly, it extends rather than closes down your potential. The proper employment of the primary control gives ever-increasing freedom throughout the entire range of movement and expression. That set of relationships between the head, neck, and other parts enables you to look at the stars, to cut your toenails, to think or move in any possible way. There is no right position for any of these activities. Even if you could find a right position, how could it possibly serve from one day to the next when the human organism is constantly changing? You would require a new right position every day and a different right position for every activity. No, to fix one position as right only serves to fix and inhibit change. Change depends on freedom, and freedom depends upon direction rather than position. The third reason why the concept of the primary control sometimes proves difficult is the fact that it is a sequential organization. It consists of relationships between particular parts, in a particular order. The correct relationship between the head and the neck is the only way in which the correct relationship between head and neck and torso can be brought about. And the correct relationship between head, neck, and torso must be brought about before the correct relationship between head, neck, torso, upper and lower limbs can be attained. In other words, it is an organization of the parts that starts at the head and moves towards the tail, involving the arms and legs in turn. It cannot be any other way. And as is implied above, progress through the sequence is cumulative. By the end, all relationships of parts are being maintained together, one after the other, and all at the same time is a phrase often used to describe this. To be more precise about these relationships, however, is problematic. We often say that the neck must be free in order that the head may be directed forwards and up in such a way to bring about the lengthening and widening of the back. But what does it actually mean? Any two people reading this are likely to have two different interpretations. Alexander struggled to find words that would accurately and unambiguously convey what he intended, but he was forced to conclude that language was simply not up to the task. The only way to communicate this information with any certainty is to demonstrate it on another person, to guide them manually and provide them with feedback where they are wrong. It is for this reason that we don't attempt to provide a complete recipe for the primary control. The teach-yourself approach, which is sometimes found, is one we do not endorse. It is far more likely to result in the cultivation of misconceptions than in fundamental constructive change. The primary control is the key to gaining control over human coordination. Yet you do not need a laboratory, a medical degree, or a vast array of expensive equipment to work with it. It is accessible to anyone who can stop, observe, and think. However, scientists who have investigated this subject in sophisticated research programs have come to conclusions which support Alexander. They have found an overall integrating pattern in vertebrates, a pattern dominated by the relationship of the head to the neck. This scientific support, however, has come largely from studies of other animals. For some reason, it seems to be more common to study animals as whole systems than to look at humans in this way. What follows is a brief look at some of this supporting work. Although none of the scientific work described below establishes the concept of the primary control exactly as Alexander defined it, the similarities and common implications are striking. Whether these findings apply exactly to humans must be uncertain. But given their correlation with the findings of Alexander, there is an accumulation of evidence which deserves to be more widely recognized. Some of the most interesting and important work was done by George Ellett Coghill. He was one of the most eminent biologists of his generation, whose research had taken him on a parallel course to Alexander. When he encountered Alexander's work, he recognized its value and publicly supported it. The endorsement of a scientist of Coghill's stature gave a huge boost to Alexander's attempts to have his work taken seriously. Coghill had gained international acclaim for his lectures on anatomy and the problem of behavior given at University College London in 1928. These described his work in an area which was his lifelong interest, the relationship between bodily organization and the mental capacities which seem to control it. He focused his studies for 40 years on a small species of salamander called amblastoma and discovered a mechanism of total integration which bears remarkable similarities to Alexander's primary control. Coghill studied the embryonic development of amblastoma and discovered that the earliest action the developing animal is capable of is a total activation of the whole organism. Either the whole animal contracts or it does not. And he discovered that this total pattern is sequenced from the head down. In other words, the contraction begins at the head end and moves tailwards. As the amblastoma develops, it begins to grow limbs. Coghill observed that these are not initially capable of independent action, but can only move if the total pattern is activated and in integration with this total pattern. In time, these limbs become capable of action that is seemingly independent, a process Coghill refers to as individuation. But Coghill discovered that such individuated actions were always subject to the integrating and coordinating role of the original total pattern. This was an important point, for he had traced the development of behavior in a vertebrate from simple beginnings in which a total head-first pattern of contraction is the only possible action to full maturity, in which the animal is capable of complex and diverse behaviors. He demonstrated throughout this development that the original head-first pattern remains as the fundamental integrating and coordinating factor in all later and more complex behaviors. And Coghill asserted that this is not unique to amblastoma.
That the early development of behavior is the expansion of an integrated total pattern has been demonstrated in amphibians, reptiles, birds, and mammals.
He had discovered the total pattern which integrates and coordinates the behavior of various vertebrates, and was convinced that the same process occurs in human beings. That is, a process in which local patterns of action are gradually, through the course of development, individuated out of the larger whole pattern, the whole retaining its role in coordinating the partial. He wrote,
"One who has exhaustive, immediate, personal acquaintance with the early fetal patterns of action can see in the growing infant, up, say, to 6 months, a progressive individuation of smaller out of larger patterns of action. And he can recognize the operation of the principle of individuation in the description of early infant behavior, as recorded by several investigators in this field."
Near the end of his life, Coghill met Alexander and had lessons in the technique. He became convinced that Alexander had discovered in humans a similar pattern of organization that he himself had studied in salamanders for 40 years. But Alexander had gone further. He had observed that this pattern is commonly interfered with, and had gone on to develop a technique to correct faults in the coordination of individuals and to bring the employment of primary control under conscious control. Coghill wrote an appreciation for the beginning of Alexander's last book, The Universal Constant in Living, in which he made explicit the connection between his work and Alexander's.
"Mr. Alexander has found these same principles operative also in man."
He expressed his appreciation of Alexander's work in the strongest terms.
"His methods are original and unique, based as they are on many years of experience and exhaustive study. Yet they can scarcely be adequately described, although the results are marvelous."
And in a letter from Coghill to Dr. Millard Smith of Boston,
"Mr. Matthias Alexander owes me nothing in regard to the principle of the total pattern. for he and I worked in total ignorance of each other until the last year or two. That he should discover the principle in the human organism is marvelous, and he deserves all the credit that the medical profession and humanity can give him.
But even though Coghill had not developed a technique to correct faulty coordination, he had come to recognize in his own work how interference with the mechanism of total integration would have pathological consequences in any organism, supporting Alexander's observations that use influences functioning and manner of reaction. In the quote below, his reference to psychopathology reflects his interest in psychology, drawing the connection between interference with the mechanism of total integration and so-called mental problems in humans.
In the interest of the welfare of the organism as a whole, partial patterns must not attain complete independence of action. They must be held under control by the mechanism of total integration. Parts become integrated with each other because they are integral factors of a primarily integrated whole. And they remain integrated, and behavior is normal, so long as this wholeness is maintained. But the wholeness may be lost through a decline of the mechanism of total integration, or through the hypertrophy of mechanisms of partial patterns. This, I believe, is the biologic basis of that conflict in behavior which expresses itself widely in the field of psychopathology.
Another eminent scientist whose work has complemented Alexander's was the German physiologist and pharmacologist Rudolf Magnus. Magnus's experiments would be impossible for ethical reasons to perform on humans, but they demonstrated in various animals the fundamental coordinating role of the central nervous system in all aspects of behavior through its organization of postural reflexes. By severing the connection between the brainstem and higher levels of the central nervous system in a living animal, Magnus could study autonomic patterns of organization and coordination. He coined the term central apparatus to account for a particular area in the brain stem, which coordinated all postural behavior by coordinating lower centers arranged segmentally in the spinal cord. He found that not only did this central apparatus control postural behavior and thus all movement and physical activity, but through the feedback of this postural behavior through the sensory mechanisms, it influenced mental activity also. Except for the fact that Alexander did not advance a theory about the internal neurology which accounts for the primary control, Magnus's discovery seems to have been of the same phenomenon. Most significantly, Magnus discovered that the relationship of the head to the neck and trunk affects behavior and posture through its influence on the central apparatus. The priority he gave in the whole process to the relationship of the head to the neck and the trunk is undeniably consistent with the head-first organization of the primary control and the head-first total pattern that Coghill discovered. Magnus found that the use of the head was primary in animal behavior. The head leads and the body follows. It is important to note that although Magnus's central apparatus functions autonomically in the brain stem, it is under the influence of the relationship of the head, neck, and torso, a relationship over which we humans can at least exert some conscious control. And although Magnus, like Coghill, worked with animals, he clearly expressed his opinion that much of his work had a bearing on man. The concept of the primary control has also provided researchers with a way to quantify the prevalence of poor habits of use in individuals. Dr. Wilfred Barlow, a rheumatologist and one of the first generation of teachers trained by Alexander, observed 109 people in the process of moving from standing to sitting, and used his understanding of this principle to assess the quality of their coordination. He did this very simply by measuring the amount by which they retracted their heads in the process. That is, the amount their heads moved in the wrong direction relative to their necks. With the proper employment of the primary control, there should be no head retraction. He found that all subjects but one retracted their heads. And when they were asked not to do so, only 11 were able to prevent it. There is also considerable support in modern scientific work. In 1989, the Second International Union of Physiological Sciences Conference was held at Fontainebleau near Paris. There, a satellite symposium met to specifically consider head movement control. It resulted in the joint publication of 115 technical papers under the title The Head-Neck Sensory Motor System. Running throughout these papers is the recognition of the primary importance of the head and neck to the behavior of the whole animal. In the preface, the editors state,
"The need for a thorough analysis of all aspects of head movement control is all the more important because head movements are a core element of orienting behavior involving a number of interactive sensory and motor systems."
The following are a few excerpts from these papers. One paper on head position and posture in newborn infants describes both how neck reflexes affect the limbs and how breathing is modified by posture. Another paper describes the cervical spine as being the most complicated articular system in the body. What is most interesting is the report that either awake or in sleep, the neck moves over 600 times an hour. No other part of the musculoskeletal system is in such constant motion. This discovery makes sense in the light of Alexander's discovery of its primary role in the coordination of activity. More than one author contributes papers confirming the role of proprioceptors in the neck in controlling posture. And another described this process as a complex coordination of excitation and inhibition. Inhibition is another concept in the Alexander technique that we will meet in the next chapter. Yet another paper points out the loss of motor coordination that results from the disruption of the activity of the neck in postural reflexes, similar to Alexander's concept of interfering with the primary control. It goes on to emphasize how the perception of the relationship between head and body is vital for successful interaction with the environment. There is also a paper by an author who asserts that in man, the neck reflexes are likely to be controlled by some higher part of the central nervous system than in animals, and suggests that a system of internal representation plays a part in the correct working of these reflexes. This supports the idea of using conscious thought, giving directions, which are an important procedure in the Alexander technique, and which you will also meet in the next chapter. And two separate authors assert, like Alexander 100 years previously, that pulling the head back and down increases postural instability and interferes with the smooth coordination of walking. And finally, one author supports the psychophysical argument by linking imbalance arising from the neck with conditions of tension, irritability, vertigo, loss of concentration, headache, numbness, and poor memory. Although none of these scientific papers fully describes the primary control, in aggregate, they present a compelling body of work which is in agreement with Alexander, although focusing on specific aspects of functioning and expressed in a much more technical idiom. What is important is that none of them conflict with the concept of the primary control. Alexander worked within a strictly scientific epistemology, and if scientific evidence was found that suggested that Alexander was wrong, we would have to either discard or rethink his theory. What is truly unfortunate, however, is that Alexander's work seems to be virtually unknown in this circle. He investigated human behavior using the scientific method, but he didn't have a degree or a white coat. He didn't couch his theory in a barrage of technical terms. In his day, many people dismissed him out of hand for these reasons alone. People today may be less prejudiced, but unfortunately, scientific training still consists in part of the handing down of the accepted canon of literature from previous generations. Most scientists today have still not heard of Alexander. The primary control is the heart of the Alexander technique. We learn to improve the use of ourselves by maintaining that particular use of the head in relationship to the neck, the use of the head and neck in relationship to the torso, and the use of the head, neck, and torso in relationship to the upper and lower limbs. All of this depends upon the involvement of thought in activity. It is the organizing of a relationship of parts which is impossible to accurately and unambiguously describe either in print or in diagram, and this is one of the reasons why proper instruction is necessary. A good teacher can show you in practice what this relationship is and ensure that you do not develop misconceptions. Working with wrong ideas can only cultivate new wrong habits, which might well be worse than the ones you are trying to eliminate. Perhaps the most remarkable thing about the primary control is that it is not something that you do in the way we usually understand that term. It is a natural pattern of organization which we can employ by learning to prevent the ways in which we habitually interfere with it. In other words, if you stop doing the wrong thing, the right will do itself. It requires a unique quality of conscious attention without attempting to directly bring about a result. This is a technique which is contrary to most of the ways in which we try to learn. Ways which always seem to involve something additional to do. How we actually learn to change our habits of interfering with the primary control, the procedure of the Alexander technique, is the subject of the next chapter.